We have a special alumni guests this evening. We have G. Eazy and Matt Bauerschmidt here to talk about what they've done and are doing and will do. But before that, we're going to just show you a little tour video so that you can orient yourselves to what they've been up to. So roll it, Lenny. Am I on? I am now. Well, welcome home.
Yeah, something like that.
Sorta.
Yeah.
It's not really home right now, is it?
No. I'm homeless right now.
That's what I heard. Homeless by design.
Homeless by design.
Why'd you make that?
A tour bus also. I mean, that's not like homeless, but.
Yeah. No, that's a good home. It's like living in a coffin.
Yeah. A luxurious coffin with.
Yeah. Do you have everything. A TV in your bunk? Do you have a?
We had them, but they took them out because it takes so much space.
Yeah.
This one time I was in it, like the first bus I was ever on, I turned on the TV once, and it was just like gnarly 70s porn DVD.
Nice. Oh, that's nice.
I was like, that's gross. Yeah.
That was a gift from the other guy.
Yeah. The last guy just left that
for me. What you don't want to think about at that point is your sheets.
Yeah, at all.
Do you ever have a window in your bunk?
No, they need to design them with submarine windows.
Yes.
I want to look out like.
I had a window.
It'd be incredible. That's all we talk about.
There's a little piece of like board that fits in and you can pull it out. It was.
But you got to be able to close it because like the bunks are great. When you close that curtain and it's like pitch black in there, you pass out at 7 a.m. and sleep until.
Yeah. You could, until they need you.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty great. Well, it's obviously you guys have been doing this for a while. This is not overnight success. I know that. I had you in my intro class, yeah, my first year here,
yeah,
and this is my fifth year here.
Yeah.
So it's pretty great what's been going on.
It's a continuous work in progress, you know?
And Matt is an older man, so I didn't have... I didn't have you in intro.
No, we were together in music marketing.
In my marketing class. Yeah. Yeah, but not in intro. Right. But you guys did your marketing plan in my class on Life's a Party.
Yeah.
It was cute. That was good.
Yeah.
It was good. You have nothing to be ashamed of.
No, I'm always...
I have it, as a matter of fact. I was going to show it. No,
please, please, please. No. I want to find all the old stuff. I can just burn it and throw it away.
No, see... there's a price for that.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you want me to burn it,
it's pretty bad.
You know, I'll send you my routing number. Anyway, most recently you've been opening for Lil Wayne.
Yeah, and it sucked.
Right. Tell me why, because there seems to be. Yeah, there seems to there. That's my. Would you shut it? I'm asking a question.
No, I mean, it was like...
What did you tell us why it sucked?
I don't want to sound ungrateful, and we learned a lot this summer, and it was like a good experience, and I mean, we got paid, we were on the bill, we had a bus all summer. It was just like, I've always been told, like, it's better to build your own brand, build your own following around your music, and we kind of took the tour because it's not something you say no to, but in retrospect, it was like, as soon as we got out there, it was pretty frustrating. It was like, I spent the whole last year building up, you know, my own thing, and had headlined two tours, and it was like this really gratifying feeling to go from opening up the bottom of a bill of a tour and just being stoked to be on tour, and then the next tour, main support, and kind of the growing pains of like, you know, I can't wait to headline my own thing.
Yeah.
And I'd rather play smaller rooms, headlining my own thing and build that, and, you know, play for my fans every night. And then we went out this spring and had a really successful run, like sold out like 40 dates across the states. And that was like, you know, this is what I want to be doing. This is
what
we've been working for 10 years for.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it was like from that back to, you know, the bottom of the bill, no one's there, like working with shitty people.
Being treated a little bit.
Yeah, totally treated like peons. Yeah, and like, yeah. I mean, we are compared to them, but it was still like kind of shitty.
I hate to use the word. For a towel and the guy's like,
the production manager on the tour. Yeah, so we never got a dressing room. Young Money, who didn't even come out on stage, got a dressing room.
Wow.
I would go to ask for a towel to bump somebody else's dressing room and take a shower. And the production manager, like, this is like first week, he's like, aren't you the opener of the opener of the opener of the opener?
Oh,
fuck you. It totally just shitted on me, and I was like, man, that was mean.
Yeah, that's the wrong way to do that. That's the wrong way to do that anyway. You should have said, aren't you the opener of the opener of the opener?
Right, yeah, yeah. He wasn't even clever about it.
Not even smart.
Yeah.
So, duh, but anyway, I hate to throw the word out there, but it seems like the situation is dependent on values, right? Obviously, there's a disconnect
corporate culture,
between
man.
Lil Wayne and your values, right?
Yeah.
I have a feeling that if you had a younger rapper opening for you at some point.
Oh, no,
point.
I'm totally going to shit on him when he comes and asks for it.
Come on, break the cycle!
Yeah. No, for sure. I mean, that's a lot of what I learned here was, you know, we talked about values and ethics, but corporate culture.
Yeah.
And that's something your whole team, your whole company kind of embodies, and their corporate culture was just kind of fucked.
Yeah.
We did Vans Warped Tour the year before, and it was like the complete opposite.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
The headliners were on the same levels like anybody else, you know.
Yeah.
You'd like it was the set times are random every day, so you may play the last slot, you may play at 11 a.m.
Right.
So it was safe.
Well, I had a band out on the road with REM for 3 months, and
yeah,
it was like we didn't want to go back to clubs. It was so great. Everything sounded beautiful.
Yeah.
We were treated like gold, and the dressing rooms were beautiful, and they carried our gear for us, and it can make all the difference if you bring your values to your enterprise. And so.
Yeah.
So, Maddie, from your standpoint, what do you do when he's out? You guys are doing that, and what are you thinking? How do you manage that situation from your standpoint?
I don't want to like quite say it was like jail, but it
Stop
was like
picking on my artist.
Yeah, it was almost like jail. I was like, I'm gonna do a favor for this guy. I'm gonna get him some comp tickets on a day that I can. I'm gonna get this guy what he needs on some other day. I'm gonna, you know, just help all these different people, and that way, you know, like they don't really see it, but it's like, okay, that's the reason your gear now gets like you get a small sound check, or like we'll have the stagehands help us carry the stuff, or like if he wants to jump in the crowd, I'll clear it with security before, and like. and that guy will end
you
up
buy everybody
with a bottle
of liquor. They
yeah, exactly.
Your favorite
yeah.
people.
They have a bottle on their desk the next day, and they're like, "Oh, cool. What do you guys want to do today?" You know,
yeah,
as opposed
funny.
To
like nursing those liquor. Relationships.
Like I can't believe that's current.
It's just all favors, though.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It's favors. You basically politicking
right.
on behalf of trading in favors, right? That's it. So I know you're going to say you're going to let me. You know that I'm concerned, and that you've quit smoking. No, okay. There's a video of you smoking, a cigarillo, right? And apparently you did a lot of takes of that video.
Well,
you
wanna, the thing is, you talk it was like,
talk about that?
Well, the thing is, it slowed down to 120 frames per second, but we had to shoot it in real time. So it seems simple when you watch it, like these assholes made a video of just like smoking for 3 minutes, like
but it was
stupid.
Beautiful.
But the thing is, like when the smoke hits on beat, that had to be like, so we had a track that was like 1, 2, 3, exhale, 1, 2, 3, right. move, 1, 2, 3. And you had to hit that all like perfectly on cue, because if it was like a second off, when you slowed it down, it was way off.
Because it's because when you're,
there's
when
no
you're
editing,
taping,
so
you're taping
like,
at a very high speed, so
yeah.
that you're using less, you're using more tape for more information, and you get these beautiful high resolution images that can be in tiny increments, right?
Yeah.
And it's a beautiful effect. It's like a, it's like a
slow-mo just looks epic.
And black and white.
Yeah.
Very beautiful.
Yeah, we cheated. It was just like.
Good, great light.
Yeah.
It was really great. So talk about the new recording. You guys are working on something right now, and I believe that one of our current students is involved.
Yeah.
As producer, for instance.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
Yeah.
Well,
the whole thing is like,
Anderson, right?
You know, content is key to everything, as I kind of believe.
What do you mean?
I mean, in taking steps forward with your career, it happens, you know, through a lot of stuff, but content is always key.
Oh,
and I mean, like, content, yeah. Music videos, you know, strategically rolling it all out the right way, but, you know, I wanted to do the record that I've wanted to do for a long time. It's like, you know, take time on every track and put the work in, and you know, so I'm really excited about this new album. We worked on it all summer, me and Christoph, and that was the one thing I could take from the Wayne tour, was that, you know, we had a studio set up in the back of the bus, and it was like every day when I'd get off stage and I'd be all bummed, like, well, that sucked, like,
yeah,
I'd get off stage and I'd go back to the studio, and it was like, well, if you're mad at, you know, being here on the bill,
yeah,
like write these songs, finish this album,
yep.
that's gonna like propel your career up to here.
I think it's really interesting too, because I used to talk about, well, I still talk about this, you know, knowing what your perfect day is in the record, if you're gonna be in this business, what kind of day are you hoping to have? What's your perfect day going to be?
Yeah.
For me, I was always able to identify two kinds of perfect days in this business. One was a tour day.
Yeah.
Where you kind of wake up somewhere and you start and you get to know the local crew and you do the gig, and then at the end it's all, you know, everybody's backslapping and it's over. You've done things, you've done something. And the day had a point. And then the other kind is a day in the studio.
Mm.
Well, you don't have to choose, you get both.
Yeah, well, it's
both
rap,
the same
it's
day.
Like, you know,
yeah,
straightforward. We don't have to mic drums in this tiny back room of the studio
it's great.
You know, all that. But no, it was like, definitely, if I was getting something done every day, then that was a perfect day.
Yeah.
And this is the first time, and the bus really like opened this door, but this is the first time I had been on tour and actually gotten work done.
Yeah.
I'd always like bring my mic and bring my interface and set up and everything and get nothing done and rage every night and just.
It's too stressful to be in a van with a trailer, driving.
But even if we had
drives.
Hotels, like it would end up like just doing just dumb shit instead of working.
Yeah, yeah.
But this one, it was like, and I think a lot of it came from being frustrated with, you know, with the Wayne tour, like on when I was headlining, it was a reason to celebrate every night. It was like we just sold out to El Rey, like let's fucking rage.
Yeah, yeah.
And then on this one, it was like, you know, wow, that really sucked.
Yeah.
Let's go, you know, write songs and just work.
Yeah, you give yourself a way of sort of doing something productive any given day.
Yeah.
You want to talk any more about the new recording? Not right now.
No.
It's okay. It's a good answer. Hey, Matt. You guys have had a pretty clear idea about artist as brand. Tell me a little bit about how that's played out for you.
Basically, we work with a creative team now, and
I'm basically asking you for your philosophy and then your approach.
Yeah. What's kind of funny about that on Warped Tour, the whole time Modson, the artist we were with, he'd call us Brandon. Because we would just sit in the back lounge, just talk about branding and marketing all day. And like, so he was, hey, Brandon, like, you know. But we try to just have everything fit the brand. Like, everything would be perfect. Like, if this was a headlining show, that'd be the new logo, and it'd be the inverse colors of that. That way it'd be black on a white. And just everything perfect, and that you can't leave anything to chance. You know, like, we have a backup mic usually when we do live shows, and we have, you know, when we do the Wayne shows, we insisted on having scrims, so it shows the branding and the logos for, for photos, and like, just every chance to have like the perfect look, you know, and come out more for music videos and just everything like that.
Well, we talked about this in marketing, you know, everything communicates. Everything communicates. Everything from how you answer emails to how and when you take phone calls to
the fonts on our day sheets,
fonts to and the scrims and your timing sheets, your day sheets. Everything communicates, and so you're always asking yourself, where's the leakage? Which is a yucky word, but you're always asking yourself, where am I losing an opportunity to communicate something about who or what I am? And you guys, you want to talk a little bit about that? Like,
it's the story that you tell to the world, and that's what the brand encompasses. I mean, it's the like overarching philosophy of who you are and how you approach everything, and it comes down to quality control, like he's saying, like making sure everything's on point and you don't let anything slip. But it's also just like
starting, you know, with the music.
Yeah, with the music and my image and all that is the story that I tell to the world, and then the rest of the, you know, everybody else, like, you know, on the team, like lives up to that level that everyone represents, you know, the brand in a positive way. But, you know, it's like the single most important thing for any up-and-coming musician to be mindful of, to think about every single day, is like building that brand. Yeah. And you guys echoed that over and over again in class, but it was like, you know, I can't say it enough, is like who you are means more than like almost anything in music. Like the image sells, the story sells, and all that fits into the brand. And it's like, you know, hashing that out, like identifying that and conveying that, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And you know, being your authentic self is really your only unique differentiator in your brand, right? So what's more of a differentiator than you? And I think you guys understood that intuitively. You never really bucked against that idea.
But you still have to be like really honest with it, because we, multiple years ago in the time that won't be named, had like a different image, and we were just like pounding ourselves against the wall, like this is not working.
Yeah.
And so we were like, what will work? Like, what's stickier? What's a better look for G to come out as branding wise?
Yeah. No, I remember when that happened.
We approached that, try to do it authentically as possible, so it's not just like, oh, a gimmick that we're doing like a 50s look or...
Well, there is the idea of taking no for an answer.
Yeah, and having the balls to really look yourself in the mirror and say, like, you know, is this working? And if it's not, go back to the drawing board and reinvent. Yeah. I think everybody, you know, any creative in the world, whether it's a musician or whatever, you know, when you make something, half of you is like, yo, this is the dopest thing in the world that I've ever done. You know, and you put it out to the world, and if it doesn't stick, like, you throw it on your SoundCloud and it gets like 200 plays, you're like, well, they just don't get it, or I just haven't been discovered yet. Yeah. But it's like, sometimes you have to go back to the drawing board, and you have to make sure that, like, whatever you're doing is remarkable, and I say that in the sense of remarkable, worth talking about, and it's like, if it tells a story, worth talking about, because if not, it's just boring.
Yeah.
And it's like, especially in today's day and age, it's so noisy.
Well, that's why we talk a lot in this program, at least I do, about not trying to sell something crappy.
Yeah.
Like, if you're not making...
But that's just not all, you know, because it's really tough for anybody to admit that something is crappy.
No, I think, you know, it's a stage of
development. Rappers especially, like, you know, you can't tell any rapper in the world he's not the coldest rapper out. You know what I mean? He's like the best rapper alive. But it's like, you have to be able to like call yourself on your shit, and it's like, well, maybe that wasn't that tight. And I
Well, that's exactly it. And I think what we're talking a little bit more about these days in this program is a sense of self-awareness.
Yeah.
Pragmatism. Understanding like you can get over yourself and really assess
and
the performance
harder.
Of the product.
Right, right, right.
How does data play a role in what you do? Because you just described Olway.
It's night and day. I mean, if you put a project out, you know, no, don't expect it to blow up overnight. But if you put your work into a project and, you know, the album art's on point and you did what you could to get your project to everybody you could and it's reaching blogs and all that, and you didn't see a big jump in your socials or anything like that, or if you make a little jump, the idea is like to keep pushing forward. It's like, you know, it's never gonna happen overnight, but if you're like continuously putting stuff out, and nothing's happening, then it's like, well, maybe the approach is wrong.
Matt, we talk a lot about a dashboard. You know, you talked about like looking at numbers, how your social media numbers move or don't move. What elements are in your dashboard right now for measuring performance? What needles do you try to see move?
I mean, you were saying monthly iTunes sales reports, but because that's kind of our lifeblood, even though, you know, recorded sales are down. But I mean, like concert tickets, obviously, and how quickly shows sell out versus day of walk up, and
you track what? You track
like how shows are selling, whether we need to like push them harder.
Sell out pre, you know, sell out pre and then
month in advance, week of, and like we try to evaluate, oh, this market, we played college shows before, so we have an older fan base. Mm-hmm. We expect more walk up versus, you know, advanced sales. Right. One of the biggest indicators we look at is YouTube numbers, because YouTube videos are like one of the biggest things that bring people to shows. So you try to manage your own expectations, and like this video is coming out in order to sell tickets right before a tour. We put Loaded out right before the Must Be Nice tour. Other times, like Plastic Dreams didn't get the numbers that we were expecting, but it was still like this, like his fans started treating him different after that. So it was more of like a positioning.
He was a positioner.
Right.
Yeah,
different videos, you try to do different things and manage expectations and see what we're shooting for with that project.
That's great. Am I right in thinking that the elements in your dashboard are changing slowly, but all the time? Yeah.
Yeah, give or take.
I mean, how much do you care about Facebook and Twitter numbers?
Yeah.
Do you care?
I mean, no, for sure.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's been a constant. It's like 1,000 followers a week.
Yeah. So you always want to see that sort of.
But also that to the sense where he'll know to switch between like more of a candid photo or like a show photo versus a portrait, and just kind of keep the Facebook and Instagram
dynamic. Because that helps you
strategize. Yeah, it's just more dynamic, and then you know, like, oh, I have a big tour announced. Do I want to put, what kind of photo do I want to pair with like a link in my Facebook in order to get the biggest response? Because this always gets the best response.
Yeah. Right. Sorry, you want to add something?
Yeah, it's also where we're at in the cycle. Like right now I'm in like writing mode. Yeah. So I have 3 months before the next record and the next tour kicks off, you know?
Does that mean quiet for you, or does that mean?
No, you keep content coming out at least like once every 6 to 8 weeks just to keep your name out there. Because if you disappear for too long, it's like, damn, fuck happened to G, he fell off.
Well, also,
but it's like you keep content coming out, but you manage your expectations to say that, like, you know, we're going to get a big boost when it's like full on season. We're rolling out these big ass videos, growing into a tour.
Yeah.
The tour is going to run 8 weeks, and throughout this whole thing, it's going to get a massive jump. And then in the down period where I'm kind of just like chilling, writing, recovering, coming back to life, like it's going to be slower, but you always want to see that increase.
And there's an opportunity to do some storytelling in that quiet period.
You live, so you have something to talk about.
Exactly. Yeah. And you're actually bringing about a project, which a lot of people like to watch vicariously. At least your core likes to be a part of that.
Yeah.
Well, that's the point of the tour videos, really.
Yeah. To entertain.
Telling the story.
Telling the story. Hey, Matt, I want to hit you first, and then Gerald, if you want to add anything to this. I want to talk about, I just had a meeting with somebody today who's trying to reach a goal, right? So I want to talk about how much goal setting you do and how much strategic planning you do. And what I'm referring to specifically is setting a goal that is difficult but attainable, and then understanding doing a current assessment of where you're at, and then being able to break that into concrete, actionable steps. Mm-hmm. How much of that do you do? You want to, one of you talk about that first and then the other one?
Yeah, we definitely put together rollouts for like months at a time, and be like, we need this release to come out on this day. And it's a blessing now, because we finally had the whole summer to work on new content. We have videos in the vault, we have songs in the vault. Yeah. Whereas in the past, we would just finish a song and be like, we need to put this out because, you know, people will be sleeping on us. But now the trick is to hold back and resist the artist's urge to like, I just made the tightest shit ever, we need to get this out right now.
Yeah,
so, you know, saving up enough stuff, coming up with the right plan, having a rollout for like 6 to 7 months at a time. And it's flexible though, it's not like set in stone. We'll constantly like push deadlines or move stuff around or add new things to it, but we'll still be like, all right, every 6 to 8 weeks, what's coming out? This song, this batch of throwaways, it's not making the album, this music video, but this music video might position his fans to think he, you know, changed too much on the Wayne tour and become too mainstream, so maybe we put out this other anthem that fits his core at the same time, or establish the sound of the album.
You're telling the story with releases.
Yeah.
Exactly, and push the positioning different ways.
Yeah, and the point that I find so important is that you guys plan.
Mm. Oh, it's super heavy.
You plan. Do you want to talk a little bit about
that? Yeah. I want to talk about I mean, goals are super duper important, and the early goals that really like got this going was when I was finishing up here. The goal was like to figure a way to pay rent when I got out of college. So I was like, you know, I figure to get this ball rolling and to get going, we need to be touring. And we were trying these DIY tours that, you know, worked better for like DIY bands in that scene, but for hip hop, it was really tough. So we were like, you know, it's gonna be internet based. I need a booking agent. A booking agent will hopefully get me opening up some tours. If I get on opening up for anybody I can bust my ass and I can steal those fans. And maybe the next time I can open up a bigger tour or be main support. If I go main support for somebody else, I can steal their fans and I can get out and I can finally headline and finally make some money to pay bills and build a following. And then finally, put an album on iTunes to make some money to, you know, pay the bills, create new content, you know, make these expensive music videos and get to the next level. But it was always like a tier of goals, and it started just like, how do I get a booking agent to get me on tours? And it was like everybody I had known in the kind of like blog hip hop circuit was like, you know, they started with one semi kind of viral music video, followed it up with a mixtape that got a lot of coverage on blogs. So for us, that was like Runaround Sue. Yeah. That was like the first video that caught, and you know, we did homework like all summer on that video and kept rewriting the treatment and making sure it was sticky enough. Mm-hmm. Put that out, followed it up with a mixtape, and then that's what got me to the agency group and got me on like my first tour and kind of set things.
And before that though, we even like practically stalked bloggers. We would know which blogs post what. They're not going to post this song because it has this feature and they never fuck with that guy. Or just, you know, and like completely laid out. We had a hit list of blogs, and if they didn't post it, we'd follow up a few days just to get to that plateau. And then the next goal, okay, now they're going to post anything we do. What's the next goal? What's the next goal?
And you actually built relationships with those blogs.
Yeah, right. Relationships with bloggers is super duper valuable. Yeah. And we still, I mean, those are still like important to us now. But you have to be authentic, you have to be genuine. It's like the one thing these bloggers hate is like, you know, the obnoxious kid that just hounds them with
spam,
you know, spams them with like annoying emails. Yeah. With it doesn't, at that point, it doesn't even matter if the music's good or bad.
Yeah.
But if it's bad, it's just like, certainly like, dude, you just suck. I'm sorry, bro. I'm not gonna post your shit. But it's,
but you
like
can alienate something,
but if you make friends with these bloggers and you don't start out at Pitchfork, you know, you start out like here and you build these relationships, and bloggers are friends with other bloggers and they talk, and if there's something worth talking about, they share it, and you build those into relationships, and then they'll post your shit every time. And then you create that, like, okay, I have my network of at least a dozen legit blogs that'll post everything I do.
Yeah.
You know, and I figure it'll take like, you know, 3 or 4 singles to roll out before I have enough attention and enough buzz built up to put out a project. And then you follow it up with that. And then if you get good coverage on that, cool. Follow it up again, and that'll get you to the next level. And you keep going there, you keep going there until it's finally time to push the button, so to speak, and, you know, send something to retail.
Right.
And that's what we did with the last record, and it basically, you know,
did right.
Something I wanted to tell you, always iterated a lot, was like the human touch.
Wait, no, there was noise. I don't know if everybody heard you say that. What?
You taught me something that I use.
Oh my God. It's like a teacher's dream. Yeah, sorry.
But yeah, just like the human touch, like finding out the blog, he goes by Confusion, but his real name's Jacob. Yeah. And he likes this. He went to this school. And like, based on this post that you did of this artist and this song, I really think that you will, you know, like this song. Instead of just coming in with a BCC'd email that just says, hey, dash.
Yeah, yo, check out my new blah. Yeah.
The hottest song, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I would send custom emails to every single blog until we developed those relationships.
Yeah.
And eventually you've earned that trust with them that they'll, you know, you can then spend less time on the email and be like, hey, here's the link. And they're like, I know you're tight. I'll put
it
up.
Right, yeah. By being authentic and human, graceful, decent.
Human. Caring about them, reading their blog, seeing what they like. And I won't even, some of them we won't even send it to that blog because it's like, they're not going to.
Yeah, you know, why waste their time?
Exactly.
And that helps a lot. I meant to ask you guys when we were talking about data and stuff like that, metrics that you look at, things you measure. So I have to say, I'm delighted to hear you say in front of these people that you measure, that you plan, that you look at data. Mm-hmm. But also, what do you do to make sure that you have names for the faces that are in the audience? Names or numbers or something. What do you collect?
I mean, we do email blasts.
I know you're not living on Facebook likes.
No, I mean, it's like, obviously it's Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, but it's like, you know, I mean, to be honest, we don't rely on our email blasts a whole lot. I mean, you send out a blast, like the tour's coming, but we rely on basically, it's like, you know, if you put on a great show, then the kids are going to come back.
Right.
If you get up there and you disappoint them and it's like, oh yeah, I saw them live and it really, you know, right. they won't come back. The other thing is I do meet and greets after the show.
Yeah.
So every show, you know, I'll try to hang around by the merch table, and it also sells a whole lot more merch, which is tight.
Yeah.
You know, you take pictures and sign girls, you know?
Yeah.
And
whatever.
Yeah, and you know, but that like connection is super duper valuable, and it's like, it's kind of a mind fuck. It's like crazy. Mm-hmm. When you're exhausted, you just got off stage playing for an hour, jumping around, like you're like totally exhausted, but you have to sell this like really genuine interaction with them, because that 1 minute they have with you to say hi and meet you and take a picture is like what they're going to talk about for the next 6 months to a year until you come back to Chicago and play again.
Yeah, and so it's not for no reason. It's because want to
totally
do that.
And it's like, yo, you're the reason that I don't have to get a regular job right now. And it's just like, you never forget that. But you have to make them know that you appreciate that.
Yeah.
And I think that genuine interaction there is what keeps, you know, them telling the story to all their friends. And if they brought one friend with them this time, they'll come back with four next time, and they keep coming back. But it's like, you know, we do worry about that. Like, they're connected through the Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and email blast, but it's like, what if Twitter just totally falls off? You know, you got to make sure that...
You got to own an asset of some kind.
Yeah.
You know, I know that it's easy right now not to have a data asset, but you're going to need cell phone numbers, or you're going to need email addresses, something that you can own some way.
Right.
I think, you know,
part of one thing that Gio talks about is like solitaire. If you try to fill up one of your stacks too high, you're not going to have the cards to even get the other cards to show. So we try to keep everything balanced. As our merch game going, is our like live shows, is how we run this, and just everything balanced. That way you're not overly popping just on Twitter and not being able to sell tickets.
You can't buy in to any one thing, right?
Yeah. You can't buy followers and hope it's going to mean anything. You know?
Everything's balanced, right? What else did I want to ask you? Oh, what about you guys? You guys obviously have been under your own power for a long time. What's changing?
Well, we're working.
Well, let me just say.
We're gonna finish the record for a second.
I'll explain a little background for people who might not know. Right. So for years, the years you were here, you were being flown out to record company meetings and everything else, and you were. For quite some time, you opted to continue to do it for yourself because you didn't reach a point where you thought what they were prepared to offer you is what you wanted in return for surrendering some of your autonomy and your sovereignty, right? At some point, that tends to change. Very often, it's in year five of a five-year plan. Do you guys want to talk about thought process?
I'm like extremely involved in everything. So a big thing for me was creative control. Up until working with Christoph, I had produced all my own music and written all of it. I record it myself, mix it all, and I put it out when I want to. The merch, I used to design all my own merch, you know, and we always knew that, you know, I got great pride out of, you know, doing things the way I wanted to, and, you know, our team was our team, and it's like anybody involved was an A player, and, you know, but it gets to a point where the business outgrows itself. We had one shelf in my studio room in my house with all the merch stacked on it, and my girlfriend would package it up and write the name on it and take it to the post office or whatever. We'd get like an order a week. And then it was like an order every day. And then we had to buy two shelves. And then we had to move it to the living room. And the whole living room was merch. And we were bringing these like massive boxes every day to the post office. And they'd be like, dude, like, what are you doing? I can't do anything with
this. Put like a pallet on your front doorstep.
The business outgrows itself.
Especially in New Orleans, they like that.
Yeah. The business outgrows itself. And it's like, you gotta be realistic at a point. But we're figuring out how we want to do this next record. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be TuneCore, but it's like certainly, and hell, it's not going to be a fucking 360 deal or some bullshit. So it's going to be like, you know, what we want is, you know, a distribution deal and then a la carte certain label services.
Yeah.
Like, we make the creative decisions. Mm-hmm. We say when we want these records coming out, we pick the singles.
What about ownership of masters?
We want to own the masters.
Right. So it's a licensing. Yeah, a license.
Yeah, but we need to throw $500,000 at radio.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah, so. You don't do radio. I've talked about this a lot. You don't do radio without a lot of money.
Yeah.
At some point, you need a bank. So at some point, practicalities dictate that you get a bank.
Yeah. And everything up to this point has been like, you know, our main expense has been, you know, paying our team, our publicist, and shooting videos.
Right.
So it was like, okay, what's the budget for this new music video? Well, how much money do we have saved up from our iTunes checks?
Yeah.
You know, and dump all that on the music
just
video.
Reinvestment.
Yeah. Reinvest everything. And that's gotten us like a constant, you know, ascending. But it's like, if we want to take this quantum leap with the next record, it's like, okay, you know, do you want to just do it yourself and sell this many, or do you want to take this massive leap and, you know, risk it on, like throw a bunch of money at radio?
So do you have direct deals with iTunes and stuff now?
We just still do everything through TuneCore.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but we've been in talks with like a lot of other options for the next album.
Okay. But you don't want to give that away too much. You don't have to.
Nope.
We can talk. Okay. I don't know. I guess I'd like to be able to give people the chance to ask questions, and we only have about 10 minutes left, I think, right? I'm not going to ask you how your classes and work at Loyola helped you prepare, but if you'd care to volunteer a testimonial, by all means, please do.
I mean, it's what you put into it. Like, if you're coming to New Orleans to go to a party school, you can get that, and we both definitely got that as well. But I was like, I identified the teachers that I wanted to get information out of, or connections, or other students. I was like, we need like a video guy out of this. I need to know someone who can do an animation thing for me if we need it, or like, you know. And it's not like using people. It's like work trades. You know, like, I'm going to come film your live shows, and you're going to do our website and do a splash page for us. And then that's like the perfect time. And like, one of the best things that about college is the safety net.
Yes.
Like, you have the safety net.
I want to talk about that.
Yeah.
It's like, we looked at us graduating as like a ticking time bomb to when we needed to be popping.
Yeah.
We were just like, okay. It's kind of like the inverse of how sometimes in school it's like theoretical. Here's a huge budget. How would you spend this money?
Yeah.
We did it the opposite. Like, how do we make the money that we need to live and to do all these videos that we need? And
You know, we tell incoming students when we're doing like admissions days, what we want is for you to start your business when you get here.
Yeah.
For 4 years, run your business with lawyers and teachers and professionals around you who can help you organize your business and sort out your problems. Have this as your safety net.
And be able to fly when the runway ends up.
Exactly. Don't start rolling down the runway second semester senior year, but hit, you know, wheels up at that point, right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
So that's just the most important thing to think about. And I don't know, you know, I mean, that can't be said enough. Is like, unless you guys, you know, you want to spend like 2 years at or you know, doing something you don't want to do, working to pay rent or live with your parents or something like that. For me, it was like, I have to do this because if I go get a regular job, I'm not going to have time to devote to the music and keep working at this pace. And I don't have rich parents or anything like that. So it was like, I have to get this going by the time I graduate. And I was like losing sleep over that my senior year. It's like, you know, how am I going to pay rent when this gets off? And it was like, you know, it's just important to like, that's a healthy anxiety, I think, to have, and like start thinking about it freshman year. Start thinking about it in high school, you know what I mean? But it's like, because, I don't know, it's just like, it takes so much time to get a plane off the ground. Like, the overnight sensations, like, don't actually ever happen overnight, you know what I mean? And if they ever do, it's like super duper rare and short lived. So it's like, anything you see that's like big today, it took years of like working and developing and honing and like building that. And it's just a whole lot of groundwork before it's actually like profitable.
Yeah.
You know, in music, it's like, we're actually in a great era right now where it's like, you can be an independent artist and totally make a living and totally like have a massive opportunity to do what you want to do. I mean, the power's in our hands, not in stupid ass major labels. Yeah. So it's like, there's this opportunity here, but it's like, it doesn't get any easier.
No.
You know, but
the opportunity is based entirely in your ideas and your ability to innovate, to be different than other people, to be the most yourself.
But it's a balance though, because like, He Must Be Nice wasn't quite the record we wanted to put out. Right. He has a lot of like reservations about like the tempos and you know, this and what was with current trends, but we had to put that out to be on iTunes to be able to put out the next record we want to put out.
Yeah, reality is reality.
It's just all about being brutally honest and seeing what's working, what's not, knowing when you can compromise the brand if that was a compromise.
Confronting the brutal facts.
Exactly.
And never giving up hope, right? That's the idea. All right, let's have some questions. Anybody anybody have questions for G and Matt? Ethan.
Hey guys, thanks so much for coming back and really appreciate you guys coming to talk to us. You talk a lot about the importance of the fans who come to your shows. Mm. Can you touch on sort of your strategies for engaging those people after the show outside of, you know, meeting them at the merch booth?
Yeah, well, you could shout it out on stage and say and stuff like that. And it all depends on, like, you know, what works for me, like, you know, may not work. You know, it's like, it all depends on positioning and stuff like that. So for me, it's just like, you know, I appreciate every single one of you for coming out tonight. I want to hang out with you after the show. Come meet me by the merch booth and I'll like take pictures, because that's what works for me, is girls who want to do that. But it's like, if you just want to have drinks with, you know what I mean? It's like,
what about after that? Let's say someone doesn't come to the merch booth right afterwards, but you still have the opportunity to reach out to them. Do you like look on Twitter at what people are posting about your shows?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, yeah, Twitter. I mean, an extreme example of this is like a Hoodie Allen, who responds to every single tweet. But like, definitely responding to the tweets is a big thing, and it shows the fans you care. But you gotta find the hardcore fans that are the ones spreading the word about you, because one of those is worth like 20 like casual fans. So you find them, you nurture that relationship, and just become friends with them. I mean, we're in a day and age where it's like you're on the same level as a fan. Like, it's not like the superstar era is dying, and it's like you're just a regular dude who, you know.
Yeah. It's about providing different levels of engagement too, because some fans want you to ask them to promote the show. Right. So we have like a Google form where they just sign up, put their info in. Yeah. We're like, hey, please promote the show. We'll get you into this meet and greet that other people would have to buy a VIP for. So some people want you to ask them to do things to help promote the show and give them that chance.
So another question. What do we got? Oh, Alex.
So have you toured in Europe, or have you thought about anything in Europe yet?
I can't wait to tour in Europe. Probably in the spring. I'll do my first run. We'll play like, start with small rooms and underplay and just like build from there.
And what do you think of, like, would it be easier to start a fan base, like, had you started touring in Europe and then come back to America? Do you think it would have worked the same way, you get fans over there, or is it easier when you're becoming bigger, you know, you're kind of you're making that second step, and then you probably have some fans out there already, and you try to kind of cater to them? Or is it easier just to, like, you're American, go over there?
Yeah, it all depends on the situation. I mean, the music starts somewhere, and that's usually, I mean, for me, it was where I went to college. I had a pocket of fans here, and it was in the Bay where I grew up in. And those two pockets, like, bled into other parts. And then what happens is there's this overall cultural awareness when shit spreads through the internet. But it's like, if you've got something in Europe, like, you know, that some reason for it to start there. But I think in terms of me like going over there, I'm not gonna break in Europe until I, like, you know, all the way break here, and then this culture awareness just kind of spreads everywhere and it tips. Right.
But it's like you were trying to say earlier, content based. So like any person who has like a 10 million hit legitimate YouTube video is gonna be able to pull 150, 200 people anywhere. And it's like that collective consciousness
and
the internet.
The potential for micro-marketing is great in Europe anyway. I mean, you can play a very, very important London show and not have to play anything else in the UK. You can play a London show, you can play a show in Berlin or in Hamburg, you can play media centers and do a lot for a little.
That's kind of an important thing to mention, is before you did any headlining dates, we did spot dates in really key markets and did underplays. So like, we do great in Michigan, but we just wanted to like specifically do this 200 cap venue to just retarded sell it out way in advance. So it's like 2 months out and sold out, and it just sends the message that for that market, that's how it works with Eazy, you know. And then in New York, LA, Chicago, and like these key markets. So you treat certain markets much differently than other places.
And you come back, you play 500 next time, you play 1,000 cap next time, and then it just keeps building.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
I don't know. So I'm from New Mexico, which is kind of like a
505.
Woo. Which is kind of like a drab place. And I was just wondering, do you think that like your location of you being in New Orleans had a lot to do with your fandom uprising, or do you think there's like a formula and you could have done it in Nebraska or Albuquerque?
I mean, it's like the internet, you know, and if you get certain blogs to post you, that reaches like a general amount of people everywhere. If I can be totally frank and be brutally honest with you guys, New Orleans was like actually pretty tough, and I actually do the worst here. Like, I do better in Iowa City than I do in New Orleans. It was just a tough market for me. It's a bad market in general. It's like a D market disguised as a B market. But it's like, bands don't do well here. But I think, it was more so like, New Orleans did a lot for me, and it gave me a place to, you know, I played a ton of shows here and like built something here. But it was more so like, you know, honing that, and then the internet that let everything grow. It wasn't really.
Over here.
Hey, G.
What's up?
I'm Shay Briggs. I'm a rapper here, too. Mm. And you talked a little bit about how you produced your own music, or at least at first. And I don't, but I want to start. And I just wanted to know how helpful it was that you produced your own music, not only for your budget, but for your brand. I guess, like, did that help out a lot, that it was all coming from you?
For sure. I mean, it was like me cultivating my sound and developing that. Because I think, you know, production is like one of the most, it's you know, half the music right there is the production, and finding the right producer, sometimes it's luck, but, you know, finding that right sound can be the key to, you know, to building everything.
Who else? I know we have other questions. There we go.
So,
no microphone.
What?
You went to Berkeley High?
Yeah. Are you from the Bay? That's what's up, man. 07.
Did a show like 2 years ago there?
Yeah, at New Parish or La Pena?
What?
New Parish or La Pena?
No, Piedmont High.
Oh yeah, at the high school there. Yeah.
And like, you weren't really big at the time.
Yeah.
But it's just like, just from seeing you here.
Yeah. That's good. We have another question. Sorry. Yes. Leonis.
So I guess this question could be for either one of you. Here, I'll say it. You talk a lot about like building your own brand. For an emerging artist, what are kind of the pros and cons of like releasing on like a semi-big label to get more exposure versus like building up your own label? Is it worth it to do both? How do you feel about that?
I mean, it's just what you're giving up. Anytime you're signing to a label, you're obviously saying, I'm going to give up X to receive Y from you. In most cases with a label, it's we're going to give you an advance or X amount of money or X amount of marketing muscle, and you have to give an ownership percentage of your record. So if you think it's worth it, in the past, we never did. We were like, you know, we could do this on our own. We don't think you're going to add much. But with the new record, we're just exploring all the different options on how much you want to give up versus what we need. And it's like, it, as such, like a DIY kind of person and team, where it was like, we need to own everything, we need to do everything. But then you get to a point and you're like, we need these steroids to get to the next level. So like, what realistically are we comfortable with giving up? And in this case, it's more of like a distribution deal type situation as opposed to a record deal situation, probably. But I mean, it's just, you just got to evaluate, you know, what's offered and what you can do.
I have to say, I've worked with a lot of artists, and this is a more and more common attitude, but it's still uncommon for somebody to want to take the harder but more independent road, because it's just a little bit too seductive to think, I'll worry about what I'm giving up later. What I want is traction. What I want is profile. What I want is easy.
And cool.
Cool. You can say to other people, I got a deal.
Yeah.
It counts for a lot.
You're a DJ, right? Your announcement. Yeah, I mean, in like EDM world, a lot of that is like, oh, like you're on Mad Decent, you're on Fool's Gold, like you're hip, like you're cool. Yeah. And that's like a lot of it is like positioning and cosigns and stuff like that. Yeah. But I was like, I always felt like an outsider and just had this chip on my shoulder of wanting to do it myself and do it without the help. And at the end of the day, tell this story like, you know, we built this from like nothing.
Part of your brand is to be.
But that's not necessarily to say it's the only way. Like, if you're a Justin Bieber, all day, go sign something that can just, you know, push you to radio or.
Yeah.
But just whatever fits your brand, you know.
Passed up on like some of the deals that people were offering you, and I want, like, after all you've been through now, do you think it was worth it? Like, going.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that, like, at the time I thought of, like, a major record deal was like really sexy, and like that's what you know what I mean, like all you wanted to do is be signed, and I thought that was really cool. But in retrospect, looking back, it's like I'm so glad, because the music certainly wasn't there. Like, we've deleted all that old shit from the internet because it sucks. And then it's like, if that would have been what had popped and I'd, you know, I've sold everything. The whole thing is like with a deal is the longer you hold out, the higher your value gets. And back then, I couldn't tour. I couldn't, you know, there wasn't a real big following there at all. So, I mean, you know, it would have been a really shitty situation. And it's like now, you know, the ball's in our court, and, you know, the labels are like, you tell me what kind of deal you want, because we want to be in business with you, rather than like, here's this and that's it. You know what I mean? So it's like, definitely holding out, like, is super duper valuable.
But holding out if you're good. If you're good and you're gonna keep developing and you're gonna put that work into it. Otherwise,
But it's pulling the veil back and being like, oh, I'm not just signing a record deal. What are you going to offer me?
Yes.
Can you give me Spotify homepage? Can you give me iTunes homepage?
Yeah.
What are you going to give us a marketing budget? How much of our record are you going
to
take?
Yeah, and at what point are you going like, to be able to say that?
I'm signed. I'm going to get, you know, blow up instantly.
Yeah.
You know, just being completely real with them and taking away the
And being completely real with yourself to know what it is you want and to know what it is you might ask for. Sorry.
Did you guys start off producing your own shows out of Loyola, or did you have a third party that was like involved?
I booked everything for like the first like 2 or 3 years until we could get an agent, and it was everything from like we would my business partner tour managed Drake, so he would just kind of throw us on the bill, and we'd be chasing him around trying to get our own shows in between. I'd reach out to like people I knew at colleges and be like, hey, hit the programming board and book us. You know, we make this much, and it would be like three times what we've ever made on a show.
Yeah, right.
And
yeah.
Like, you know, or. Or just
that's
any,
how it works.
Any
you're connect, a manager.
Any connect you have, like a Nick Thomas, who's an alumni of the program, he helped bring us up at Throwback.
Yep.
And it's being aware of what kind of market you're in. And it's like, oh, Minneapolis, it's all ages. We can sell hella tickets. Let's do that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or it's New Orleans, it's, you know, a weird all ages market. So let's do a built-in play. Yeah. So it has this much crowd and put some other people on the bill. So it's real safe and always looks good.
Yep.
So you protect the brand at the expense of money sometimes.
Right.
Gee, will you sign my
Acceptor forum?
I got you, bro. I got you.
He signed mine right before we started.
Yeah. Sometimes it starts with words. Most of the time it starts with music. On this record particularly, I did a few of the tracks, but most of it's been Christoph. So he'll, you know, he'll do the music, he'll do the track or whatever. And then, you know, or like I'll build it with him and I'll say this, and then I'll just start brainstorming ideas, and it just like, it'll start, I'll just start mumbling stuff and words will come out intuitively, and then you just like, you know, you start with phrases here and there, and then you just, I don't know, it all depends what the music says.
I think that's all we have time for.
Oh.
What are we doing? We have one last question. Two last questions.
Okay. Hardware, software. Yeah, dude, it's all Pro Tools. We do the track and then track the vocals in Pro Tools. So, I mean, we started out with just Expand, which is just like, you know, it comes with Pro Tools and the stock piano. And actually, most of the album is just basic free shit. It's about like tweaking those sounds and making them sound good, but you don't need to. We recently like bought like a big strings pack and like a, you know, like bought some synths and stuff like that, but it's really, you know, it's just about making like free sounds sound good.
Yeah. So like when you find yourself like, I guess like chilling, I guess you could say, with like another emerging artist, like for example, I saw a picture of like you and ASAP Rocky. Like what did you take from that experience? Like, was there anything that you asked him or learned from him?
We just chill and smoke blunts and talk about music.
All right.
I think like,
and on that note, let's hear it for G-Eazy and Matt Bowersmith. Thank you, boys.